Good afternoon. Can I remind members that COVID-related measures are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Justice and Veterans. If members wish to ask a supplementary question, could I ask them to press the request to speak buttons or put an R in the chat function during the relevant question? And I call question one, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service consultation reducing unwanted fire alarm signals.
Minister Ashton.
I welcome this consultation by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Addressing unwanted fire alarm signals is a priority in the current fire and rescue framework for Scotland. This is an issue for fire services throughout the UK, placing the public and firefighters at risk by causing unnecessary blue light journeys and diverting resources away from genuine emergencies. The consultation seeks to understand stakeholders' views on the options put forward, and I would expect there to be further SFRS engagement to explore any significant concerns raised before a final decision is made on the way forward.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? One of the serious options being considered to cut call-out times by up to 85% is not mobilising blue light services in response to an automatic alarm if a follow-up call fails to confirm or verify a fire or even signs of a fire. Now, some organisations have expressed explicit concern about this already, Scottish Care for one, Presiding Officer, around the effect that may have on care homes, for example, where it's just simply not possible. Can I ask that reassurances can be given to that particular sector, but also to the wider public, that whatever the outcome of that consultation, no one will be put at risk, and there will be no increase at risk of tragedy anywhere in Scotland as a result of any measures taken to cut call-outs.
Minister.
Yes, the member is right to point that out. There's actually three options in the consultation, and two of them exempt sleeping premises, as the members rightly pointed out. That would cover things like care homes, hospitals, prisons, and so on. So a reduction in UFAS could release significant resources to deploy to more productive and beneficial tasks, including prevention and fire safety work. And although SFRS remains committed to driving down the number of unwanted fire alarms, it will always respond immediately to alarm signals with appropriate resources if confirmed or signs of fire are reporting. And as I said, it's worth noting that two of the options that are set out in the consultation, premises such as care homes and hospitals, will be exempt from being call challenged, meaning an immediate response will be sent to investigate those calls and investigate the cause of the alarm. Any potential changes in response to such premises would be discussed thoroughly before any final decision is made on the way forward.
Brief supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for outlining the work that's underway to drive down the number of unwanted fire alarms. Can the Minister outline what work is underway to modernise the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to allow it to expand its work on fire prevention and fire safety with vulnerable households?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
We are committed to modernising the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service so that it can do more to keep communities safe and contribute to better outcomes for the people of Scotland. And this was demonstrated through our continued investment in SFRS, with a further uplift of 8.7 million resource for 21-22, bringing the total budget to 343 million. And we're currently consulting on our fire and rescue framework for Scotland, and modernisation is at the heart of our priorities and our objectives for SFRS.
Thank you. Question number two, Emma Harper.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its £500 million of funding to modernise a prison estate, including any updates to HMP Dumfries.
Cabinet Secretary Keith Brown.
Our ongoing investment in our prison estate will ensure it's fit for the future. Our current priorities are the new female custodial estate, where construction is now well underway, as well as the much-needed replacements for HMP Barlinnie and HMP Inverness. This investment also includes ongoing maintenance work across the estate, including HMP Dumfries, which remains an integral part of the prison estate. And current improvement priorities for HMP Dumfries include the upgrading of flat roofing, increasing the number of accessible cells within the prison, and the refurbishment of the gym facility and replacement of existing cell furniture.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. As you well know, HMP Dumfries is one of the oldest functional prisons with one of the smallest prison populations in Scotland. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore comment on whether HMP Dumfries has similar facilities to other prison campuses in Scotland, and can he give a commitment that the welcome £500 million of investment into Scotland's prison estate will not leave out HMP Dumfries staff as well as its residents?
Cabinet Secretary.
All establishments across Scotland have similar facilities, whilst HMP Dumfries currently does not feature within the Scottish Government's infrastructure investment programme. The establishment will continue to benefit from the general investment provided by the Scottish Government for the prison estate. Improvements to the capital infrastructure of our prisons will have benefits for prisoners, prison staff and for the wider communities.
Thank you. Question number three, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of reports of a backlog in toxicology analyses, how many final post-mortem reports following a sudden or unexplained death were not issued within the 12-week target in 2020 and 2021?
Lord Advocate.
Thank you. Post-mortem reports are issued by pathologists to the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service at the conclusion of their investigations. Pathologists do not have a target to provide these reports within 12 weeks. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service aims to conduct its investigation and advise the next of kin of the outcome within 12 weeks of the initial report of the death in at least 80% of these cases. In 2019-20, 70% of cases were closed within the 12-week period, and in 2020-21, it was 59%. Previous delays with toxicology analysis have played a significant part in that 12-week target not being met, but there are also other legitimate reasons why it's not possible to conclude an investigation within 12 weeks, such as the need for further investigations with a view to determining whether a fatal accident inquiry should be held. Significant work has been done by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, toxicologists and pathologists to address this issue. Since the beginning of 2021, there has been no backlog of toxicology reports. All reports have been submitted to pathologists within agreed timescales, and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has established a dedicated team to manage the final post-mortem reports, which have now been received and require to be considered.
Monica Lennon.
I thank the Lord Advocate for the detail in her response, and I welcome her to her new role. Presiding Officer, there won't be a lot of time to respond to all of that, but this has been a deeply upsetting period for many families, because before the pandemic, bereaved families were experiencing long and agonising waits for final post-mortem reports. Instead of being told it could take around 12 weeks, many were told it could take 12 months, and some were told it could take 2 years. So I'm pleased there are improvements. But can I ask, under the new service level agreement between the Scottish Police Authority Forensic Service and the Crown Office Prosecutor Fiscal Service, what robust measures will be in place? Are families being consulted? And will the Lord Advocate meet with me and affected families to make sure that we never get this wrong again?
Lord Advocate.
Yes, so I understand entirely what Ms Lennon has said, and I understand the impact that the history of this issue has had on bereaved families. And I would be more than happy to meet and discuss this issue at significant length with Ms Lennon and those to whom have been profoundly affected, as she rightly has described. What I can say, though, this afternoon is that the success of the Toxicology Improvement Plan has meant that pathologists have received delayed toxicology reports alongside toxicology reports for more recent cases. So they have delayed reports, but they also have the new reports. And a significant number of final post-mortem reports have therefore been received by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service over this year. This is set against a background of an increase of 40% in the number of deaths being reported to the Crown from the previous year, with a resultant significant increase in the number of post-mortem examinations requiring to be instructed.
Lord Advocate, I'm going to have to cut you short there. I know you've offered a meeting to Ms Lennon,
very
and I'm
well.
Sure you can pick that up there. Brief supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you. The Faculty of Advocates have said that the delayed instruction of post-mortems is a direct result of a dearth of forensic pathologists. Can I ask the Lord Advocate if that is an assessment which she agrees with, and if so, what has been done about it?
Lord Advocate.
The delay in the provision of toxicology services related to the fact that the Glasgow University toxicology department was no longer capable of producing the toxicology reports necessary. I think what happened was in 2019, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service began experiencing significant delays in the production of these reports, and the university indicated they no longer wished to undertake the contract. Subsequently, there was a reduction in the number of staff available within the university to produce the reports. But there was a toxicology improvement plan put in place with the university, which has directly targeted the backlog of cases. And since the beginning of 2021, there's been no backlog in the toxicology reports being provided to pathologists who then need to conduct their final pathology analysis and report. So the difficulties have arisen because of the delay in the provision of forensic services from Glasgow University, which have had a knock-on effect. And I don't understand it to be the position as described by Mr Green, as he has quoted the Faculty of Advocates.
Thank you very much, Lord Advocate. Question number four, Fulton McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to implement a bailiff's house or a barn house model for children and vulnerable witnesses in criminal proceedings.
Cabinet Secretary.
Last week I announced a £2 million funding initiative to support the rollout of the new Scottish Child Interview Model, which protects children and reduces the stress associated with recounting their experiences. This is an important step towards creating the foundations of our Bairns House vision within Scotland, which we are committed to delivering by the end of the parliamentary term. On the 14th of September, we published a vision for Bairns House, setting out in broad terms a vision of how Barn House should be implemented in Scotland, the values which should underpin the model, and our approach to its practical implementation. The vision has been welcomed by Children First and others, and our next steps will be to establish a national governance group to oversee the delivery of the Bairns House in Scotland and to bring forward standards for the Bairns House. Further plans will be published by the end of 2021.
Thank you, Fulton McGregor.
Thanks, President Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and for his reference to the governance group. And I'm wondering if the governance group will look at ensuring that children and young people who are involved in sexual abuse cases, for instance, will be prioritised through the system, and also if there will be scope for adult survivors of such crimes to access these facilities, although they will be adults and may not be vulnerable other than the crimes being committed against them when cases of historical abuse are brought forward.
Cabinet Secretary.
Bairns Houses will be available to all children and to children in Scotland who have been victims or witnesses of abuse or violence, which includes sexual abuse, which the member refers to. An interagency referral discussion is the start of the formal process of information sharing, assessment, analysis and decision-making following reported concern about abuse or neglect of a child or a young person up to the age of 18 years. And it's the role of the designated police, social work and health staff involved in these discussions to consider what action will be necessary and is in the child's best interests. A referral to the Bairns House will be one of the options that could be considered at IRD. The professionals involved in IRD discussions will decide if this is appropriate and prioritise the services produced by a Bairns House based on their judgment of the individual needs of the child and the concern under investigation.
Thank you. Question number five, Dean Lockhart.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to statistics showing that the number of recorded cybercrimes has nearly doubled in the past year.
Cabinet Secretary.
We believe that this likely reflects the growing adoption of digital technologies in Scottish society, which has been, of course, accelerated by the pandemic. It's not unique to Scotland, and similar trends have emerged in England and Wales, where an increase in fraud has been linked to pandemic-related behavioural changes, such as working from home and increased online shopping. The Scottish Government is responding to the increased cyber threat through the Strategic Framework for a Cyber Resilient Scotland. Work is underway to share threat intelligence and mitigation measures, raise cyber risk awareness and deliver education and training. And the Government earlier this year founded Cyber Scotland Partnership, which includes Police Scotland and the UK's National Cyber Security Centre as founding partners. It has to be recognised, though, that these efforts to raise awareness in themselves may be a factor in increasing reporting of cybercrime, although that is difficult to quantify. So, within and out with the partnership, the Scottish Government, Police Scotland and National Cyber Security Centre work together to help protect people and organisations from cybercriminals.
Dean Lockhart.
As the Cabinet Secretary indicated, this increase in cybercrime is largely driven by a rise in online fraud. Given the impact online fraud can have on vulnerable people in particular, we are calling for harsher punishments for those who target the vulnerable. Will the Cabinet Secretary back these measures to help tackle this serious increase in online fraud against vulnerable people?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I've said before to members from throughout the chamber, we'll listen to any sensible proposals to look at things which may help us deal with, in this case, rising crime. And this was a big increase in crime over the recorded crime period that we last reported on, in fact, the biggest of all the different areas. So we'll listen to anything like the proposals which has been made by the member. If he wants to write to me more fully with that, happy to do that. It's worth saying, of course, that the bulk of the responsibility for online activity rests with the UK government, but we have to do our bit as well. And we're doing that through training, through the cyber resilience partnerships that we've mentioned. And today, earlier on, we addressed this in the senior serious organised crime task group, which has been established, and this will be the main focus of the next meeting of that group as well. So we are taking it seriously, but happy to listen to any suggestions.
I want to take a couple of very brief supplementaries. Firstly, Polly McNeill.
In the most recent Scottish Government figures, cybercrime accounted for an estimated 1 in 3 sexual crimes. That's 2021. In the last decade, most types of crime have fallen, but sexual crimes have risen by 78%. So can the Cabinet Secretary set out what measures the Scottish Government is planning to protect vulnerable people, especially women and girls, from the increasing risk of cybercrime of a sexual nature?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member is right to point to the concerns in this area. I've mentioned already some of the things which you're taking forward, but through the cyber strategy which we have and working with Police Scotland, for example, in relation to young people, keeping people safe in a digital world is the name of the initiative, and that seeks to allocate resources where they can best meet the demands of the public, communities and businesses, but with a focus on vulnerable people. So we are committed through Police Scotland to investing in its officers and staff and ensuring it's got the right skills in the right place within the organisation. And I think the member is right to say we're not at that place yet, not just with Police Scotland, but through the other agencies throughout the UK as well. There's more work to be done in this, and we have to reflect with the same vigour and ingenuity which people use these things to attack people. We've got to have the same commitment to make sure we can defend people's interests, not least the vulnerable people who Paul McNeill mentions.
Okay, and Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his responses to those questions so far. I wonder if you could say just a little bit more about what the Scottish Government is doing to raise general awareness across the Scottish public about cybercrime and the damage it can do, not only to the vulnerable people that Pauline McNeill has mentioned, but more generally across all of our communities.
Cabinet.
Well, mainly this is work done through a number of partners, especially in terms of public awareness. One of the groups which have been doing this for many years now is the Scottish Business Crime Partnership, which is based actually in my constituency, but using all the different agencies, both in Scotland and where appropriate in the UK, to try and get that message out. So there are courses which we've helped to fund in the past, which people have attended, how to protect your online presence, how to protect the software that you use from the potential for fraud, sometimes people taking over your terminal and using that for nefarious purposes. So a lot of this will be down to awareness raising, as well as I've just said to Pauline McNeill, making sure that our agencies are fully equipped to deal with the challenge in this area.
Question number 6, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what role fatal accident inquiries have in the delivery of justice in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Fatal accident inquiries are inquisitorial judicial proceedings before sheriffs or sheriff's principal, which are held in the public interest to investigate the circumstances of a death, to establish the time, place and cause of a death, and to identify reasonable precautions which may be taken to prevent deaths in similar circumstances. It's not the purpose of an FAI to establish blame or guilt in the civil or criminal sense. Fatal accident inquiries play a significant role in exposing systematic failings and unsafe working practices and ensuring there are systems to safeguard and protect those held in legal custody. Where the sheriff identifies reasonable precautions which might have avoided the accident or death, defects in any system of work which led or contributed to the accident or death, any fact relevant to the death, then they may make recommendations to prevent similar deaths happening in future.
Richard Leonard.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Over 2 years ago, I raised in Parliament the death of Alan Marshall, a young man who died in the custody of the state in March 2015. His death was the subject of a fatal accident inquiry and was highlighted once again just yesterday following the publication of an important new report, Nothing to See Here. The fatal accident inquiry concluded that Alan's death was entirely preventable, and made 13 recommendations, all to the Scottish Prison Service, but three of the recommendations have been rejected, including disallowing the use of feet as a control and restraint technique. That is, the kicking of and stamping on prisoners by prison officers, which we witnessed in Alan's case. I spoke to Alan's family yesterday. They do not understand why this continues to be rejected. So will the Cabinet Secretary for Justice instruct the Scottish Prison Service today to reconsider its decision to ignore this recommendation, and will he in due course come back to Parliament to give a considered response to this week's University of Glasgow report?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, first of all, just to point out, of course, that the outcome of FEIs is not one which the Scottish Government has any role in. But the member quite rightly raises the situation when there are recommendations which are made and they are not accepted, as is possible, it's possibly the case in terms of either a public agency or other organisations. So it is possible that they do not accept those recommendations. What I will undertake to do in response to the point that Richard Leonard makes is to look into the case, to come back to him, to see what action, if any, has been taken in relation to that by the Scottish Prison Service, and to discuss it with him further at that stage. And then at that point, perhaps we could see, if he remains unsatisfied, how we could take that further forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Brief supplementary, Russell Finlay.
The research referred to by Richard Leonard reveals severe problems, but at least deaths in custody are automatically subject to an FAI. What does the Cabinet Secretary say to families who suffer deaths in non-custodial settings and have to fight for an FAI? And is he satisfied with that scope?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I think the current system of FAIs, where it is the duty lies on the Lord Advocate to take that decision, is the right one. I'm not aware of anybody else that sustained a proposal other than that. This was discussed at length with the previous Justice Committee. They looked at some of the issues, and there are issues around this. Of course there are, not least in relation to the time taken for some FAIs. But that committee did not come forward with an alternative proposal. And I do think that the current system has major benefits to it, not all of which are often advertised in this chamber, but substantial benefits, not least in the role of the Lord Advocate and having a role in terms of criminal investigations and the joining up of that function with FAI. So I think it is the right process. It doesn't mean to say that we are complacent and that both the Government and I'm sure the Crown Office as well will always look to make improvements. Improvements have been made, further improvements are being made, and we'll continue to improve the system.
Thank you. Question number 7, Alex Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it supports veterans and what official statistics it records to monitor this.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has given an annual update to Parliament each year since 2017 on our support for veterans and the armed forces community in Scotland. We will do so again in November this year. The member will also be aware that as part of our response to the UK-wide strategy for veterans, the Scottish Government committed to improving the collection, use and analysis of veterans' data. Scotland Census 2022 will, for the first time, include a question on previous service in the UK Armed Forces, and analysis of that data will support a programme of work to better identify and support the veterans community in Scotland.
Alex Rowley.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and the census collection of data will be important. The UK Government, as a result of that, has recently announced that it will collect statistics on veteran suicides for the first time. A welcome move from the many charities and families who have long campaigned for more transparency on this issue. So can I ask, will the Scottish Government confirm that it is looking at doing likewise, and within what timescale are we looking at?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's an interesting point, and I think it's fair to say that we have, certainly I have, over many years asked the UK Government for more data, including service leaver data, which is crucial to this, and they have only just announced that they will do that with a week's notice to the Scottish Government. So, yes, we do want to undertake some of the analysis that they say they'll now take, particularly in relation to veterans that have suffered, that have died after they've left the service, and the reasons for that. So we will work with the National Registers. It's not the same as ONS, there are different procedures, but we will work with them to try and get the same output of information and analysis of that information. I just wish it had happened many years ago.
Thank you. Supplementary, briefly, Fiona.
As the Cabinet Secretary will appreciate, the few remaining Korean War veterans are very elderly. They took the decision to hold their last ever memorial service at the Korean War Memorial in Bathgate in my constituency last month. Will he send his best wishes to those remaining Korean War veterans and the newly established trust who have agreed to take over this distinctive Korean War Memorial, the only one in the country and the Garden, for the future?
Very briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I'm grateful to have the opportunity to pass on my best wishes to the remaining veterans of the Korean War and to pay tribute to all those that served in the conflict. There is more I'd wish to say. We don't seem to have time, but I would say to the member, and she might not be aware of this, that I intend to visit the memorial, which she will know very well, in the coming weeks, and we'll get back in touch with her on that issue.
Thank you. Question number 8, Donald Cameron.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support Police Scotland in its upkeep of the police estate.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the allocation of resources, including for the police estate, is for the Scottish Police Authority and the Chief Constable to determine. We have committed to protect the police resource budget in real terms in every year of the current Parliament, as we did in the last parliamentary term. Scottish Government funding for the Scottish Police Authority in 21-22 increased by £75.5 million, bringing the annual policing budget to more than £1.3 billion. In relation to ongoing investment in its estate, Police Scotland will continue to ensure that in all cases the focus will remain on health and safety first, in terms of its approach for all officers, staff and for the public.
If it's possible, Don.
Thank you. In 2019, in this chamber, I raised the concerns of the Scottish Police Federation about the poor state of Oban Police Station, described by them as far and away the worst police station they have ever encountered. I understand that in December last year, Police Scotland ordered a feasibility study to look into a new premises for Oban's hard-working police. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on this, and will he commit the government to any additional funds needed to ensure our police in Oban and elsewhere in Scotland have a safe and modern premises to operate from, given the dire state of Scotland's crumbling police estate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to the member, I'm happy to be in touch with those that are responsible, Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority, on the issue that he's raised. On the general point of funds, I would simply say I've just detailed the increased expenditure, increased budget we made available, which incidentally was £15 million more than the Conservatives approached at budget time. It's also true to say we've just gone through a decade of austerity, in case the member hadn't noticed that. And it would be easier if Police Scotland were not facing, as Mr Green found out at committee this morning when he asked the question, an additional £11 million cost because of the national insurance increase by the UK Government. These things have to be paid for, and they squeeze other resources, and it would be good if the member could recognise that.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. We now move on to the next set of portfolio questions, which are finance and economy. Again, if members wish to ask a supplementary, please press the request to speak buttons or an R in the chat function at the relevant question. And I call question number 1. Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle the reported increase in underemployment.
Minister Richard Lockhead, sorry.
Underemployment can affect workers who are unable to secure work that matches their skills and qualifications, and the Scottish Government's Future Skills Action Plan sets out our approach to addressing challenges, including skills underutilisation. This includes providing workers with access to upskilling and retraining opportunities to meet their needs and circumstances, while at the same time delivering a skills system that understands and reflects the needs of employers. Workers can also face underemployment due to a lack of working hours to meet their financial needs. And while employment law is, of course, reserved, via the Fair Work Agenda we have here in Scotland, we have introduced a Living Hours Employer Accreditation Scheme, which is now being implemented across Scotland as from last August, this August.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much for the answer. According to annual population survey published last week, underemployment has increased in 22 local authorities. As many as 219,100 people are underemployed across Scotland, with the city of Edinburgh facing one of the largest increases across the year. The underutilisation within our labour market will only stop our Scotland's economy recovery. Underemployment normally rises in recessions because part-time work is second best for people who want full-time work. Therefore, I ask the Minister, how many full-time work opportunities are the Scottish Government creating from their National Transition Training Fund?
Minister.
The Scottish Government has a number of initiatives in place at the moment, including the National Transition Fund, to support training and employment opportunities. And of course, given the impact of COVID, there are many different dynamics at play in the Scottish economy at the moment. And the member's quite right. Statistics from the annual population survey show the underemployment rate in Scotland The proportion of people in employment that would prefer to work more hours was estimated at 8.5%, taking the figures up to March 2021. So that's one dynamic the member quite rightly highlights that's at play at the moment in the Scottish economy. That's why the accreditation for living hours is so important, and why in the last few weeks it has been introduced in Scotland, to make sure people get a decent number of hours to earn a decent income. And of course we continue to support the rollout of the Real Living Wage in Scotland to make sure people get a decent level of salary and wage for the work they're doing as well. And more people in Scotland, a bigger proportion, have the real living wage in comparison to elsewhere in the UK. So we are making progress, but there is some way to go, and the issues the members raise are very important and at the heart of our thinking.
Thank you. Supplementary, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Premier Officer. The UK Government's decision to end the furlough scheme will have a substantial impact on many low-paid workers and risk forcing many households into financial insecurity. Does the Minister agree with me that this decision should therefore be reversed urgently?
Mr Lockhead.
Yes, it's a point well made. It continues to be the Scottish Government's policy that the UK Government should make appropriate support available and not end support in terms of furloughing, because, of course, it's still a very anxious time for many employers in particular sectors in Scotland at the moment who may well require ongoing support. And, of course, at the end of the July, 116,500 jobs in Scotland were still supported by the furloughing scheme, and many are today as well, or would have been. So that's why the Scottish Government does say to the UK Government, please make sure you do not cut off this vital support.
Question number two, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will respond to the calls being made by trade unions and activist groups and allocate an additional £17 million in funding this year to support the local authority services currently managed by Glasgow Life.
Mr Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Government does not underestimate the severe impact the COVID-19 pandemic has had on the arts and cultural sector in Glasgow, which is hugely important to the wider city economy and Scotland's cultural life. Councils are autonomous bodies responsible for managing their own day-to-day business. They must deliver services as effectively as possible. It is for local elected representatives to make decisions on how best to use their resources to deliver services to their local communities. How this is done is a matter for each council. Glasgow City Council will receive a total funding package from the Scottish Government of almost £1.5 billion in 2021-22 to support the provision of local services, which includes an extra £29.8 million to support vital day-to-day services, a 2.2% increase when compared to 2020-21. And finally, Glasgow City Council has already been allocated an additional £221.7 million to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic and lockdown through the local government settlement, over and above their regular grant payments.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Of course the pandemic's had an impact, but let's look at the preparedness and the situation as the pandemic hit. Over the past decade as a whole, Glasgow Life's block grant from Glasgow City Council has been cut by 8%, and this government has cut Glasgow City Council's budget by over 10%, so clearly there are interdependencies. And for the leader of Glasgow City Council, Susan Aitken, to continue to claim
Question.
That the proposed venue closures come as a result of COVID is disingenuous at best. So will the Scottish Government please get a grip on this situation, provide local authorities with the funding they need, and stop taking Glaswegians for fools?
Minister.
As I made reference in my original answer, it is a matter for local authorities to decide how they allocate their funding. We have given a fair settlement to local government over the past 10 years, 10 years of austerity inflicted upon us from Westminster. But the point I would put to the member is a very simple one. As he is aware, health is becoming an increasing part of the budget. That has a corollary. So if he wishes to see increased resourcing for local government, it is incumbent upon him and his colleagues to identify where that resource should come from.
Brief supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update as to the funding which has been made available to support the culture sector in Glasgow over the pandemic?
And a brief response, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has supported organisations and individuals in Glasgow during the pandemic with more than £18 million through the Creative Scotland COVID-19 Culture Organisations and Venues Recovery Relief Fund and other COVID-19 targeted funding programmes. And I would be happy to provide more details of that to the member in writing.
Thank you, Minister. Question number three, Maurice Goldman.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to promote sustainable public procurement.
Minister Ivan McKee.
Yeah,
That's it now. I'll start again, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is committed to using public procurement to help achieve wider economic, social and environmental outcomes, including a national climate and procurement forum to ensure public procurement is contributing to our ambition of becoming a net zero economy. We have mandated sustainable procurement through policy and legislation and promote widespread application through the Sustainable Procurement Tools platform, which provide a one-stop shop for guidance, e-learning and case studies. This year, we added a revised Introduction to Sustainable Procurement e-learning module and a Climate Literacy e-learning module, which has been widely used and is mandatory for buyers in several organisations, including the Scottish Government.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you. Third sector involvement in sustainable procurement is supported through the Scottish Government's multi-supplier framework reserved for supported businesses. However, it is limited in its scope, with only a handful of suppliers on the framework covering a limited number of commodity areas, meaning the vast majority of Scotland's third sector, who are defined as supported businesses under Scotland's 2014 Procurement Reform Act, are excluded. Will the Minister commit to reviewing the scope of the framework and look at ways in which this could be extended in advance of the next re-tendering of the framework agreement?
Minister.
As a member is well aware, the supported businesses are hugely important and a great area of focus across all the work within procurement, and I can undertake to have a look at the issue that he raises to see what else can be done on top of all the other work we've undertaken specific to those particular frameworks to extend the scope for supported businesses to take part in bidding for that work.
Thank you, Minister. Question number four, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what work it has undertaken with Inverclyde Council to encourage business development and inward investment into Inverclyde.
Okay, Minister Ivan McKee.
We are working closely with Inverclyde Council and other local partners to ensure that Inverclyde is rightly seen as an attractive location for businesses to invest and grow. The Scottish Government is providing £500 million through the Glasgow City Region deal that will support a number of projects at Inchgreen, Ocean Terminal and Inverkip, significantly enhancing the region's ability to attract new investment and business. In addition to a share of the place-based investment programme over the next 5 years, Inverclyde Council has been awarded a further £2.9 million from the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund to support three local projects. And our commitment to the economic well-being of Inverclyde is further demonstrated through the significant support given to key industrial projects, such as a £13.7 million package of major inward investment support provided to Diodes, delivered through Scottish Enterprise, and the work that is underway at Ferguson Marine will equip the yard to compete for new orders and new contracts in the future, retaining vital jobs and skills for Inverclyde.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Minister for that reply, and the Minister will be aware of the high levels of deprivation in parts of Inverclyde, but also the historic and ongoing population decline. I'm aware that local authorities are able to submit a specific business case to the Scottish Government for additional funding out with the local government settlement. And can the Minister confirm whether such a proposal actually has been forthcoming from Inverclyde Council? And if not, what additional resource, in addition to what the Minister has already touched upon, the Scottish Government is currently allocating to Inverclyde to tackle deprivation and population decline?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
I stated in my previous answer, we are working closely with Inverclyde Council and other local partners across a range of opportunities for additional funding being made available to local authorities through our City Region Deals, Place-Based Investment Programme and Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, to name a few. In some cases, as mentioned, funding has already been allocated with work already underway in projects across Inverclyde. In other cases, such as Inchgreen, the full business case is due later this year. When ready, this will require approval by the Glasgow City Region Deal Cabinet in accordance with existing deal governance.
Thank you. Question number five, Neil Bibby, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of the decision to remove the cohesion target from the National Performance Framework, how it is monitoring whether the employment gap is narrowing between the best and worst performing areas?
Minister Richard Lockhead.
The Scottish Government regularly carries out analysis on the labour market for local authority areas. On the 29th of September 2021, the annual national statistics publication, Scotland's Labour Market, People, Places and Regions, was published containing up-to-date employment rates estimates for local authorities, amongst other measures, for April 2020 to March 2021. Between January to December 2017 to January to December 2020, the gap between the combined employment rate for the three best local authorities and the combined employment rate for the three worst performing local authorities has reduced over time, with a gap of 11.8 percentage points in 2020, down from 16 percentage points in 2019.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Regional policy was a welcome feature of the recovery strategy unveiled yesterday, but the reality is for years that the Scottish Government have been erasing regional equality from its economic frameworks. The west of Scotland is living with historic inequalities. Our region contains areas with the highest unemployment in Scotland and areas with the greatest levels of deprivation in Scotland. Targets requiring action on regional inequality can drive change. So does the Minister agree there is a case for setting clear, new, ambitious targets now to close the employment gap and make the economy fairer for West Scotland?
Minister.
Regional policy is something I take a great interest in, but I think it's difficult for the member to say we've not been implementing regional policy, given that we've agreed funding for city and region deals across Scotland of over £1.9 billion worth. And regional partners anticipate this will support over 80,000 jobs and attract over £1 billion of additional investment across Scotland's cities and regions as well. But of course, regional policy is very, very important going forward. And clearly, the government is looking at economic transformation of Scotland for the next 10 years. And I'm sure the Advisory Council are looking at the role of regional policy. And we look forward to their deliberations. It's also a very important point to raise in the context of the question that, given Boris Johnson, the Prime Minister's reference today to levelling up across the UK, so far he's refused to involve the Scottish Government to any meaningful degree in terms of how these funds will be spent and invested in Scotland's regions in terms of regional policy and levelling up across Scotland and the UK. So I'm sure the member will want to support us to make sure we can help shape how that funding is invested in Scotland as well.
And brief supplementary, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, and I refer members to my entry in the Register of Interest, which shows that I'm still a member of Aberdeen City Council. The Conservative Labour Administration Aberdeen City Council has launched EBZ Works, which will help people into much-needed jobs, training and education. Now, given this initiative is funded directly by Aberdeen City Council without any Scottish Government support, can the Minister confirm that this excellent example of local authority proactivity will be used as an exemplar for Scottish local authorities in the National Performance Framework?
Minister.
The member highlights one of many impressive local projects that local authorities have implemented to support employment in the local communities. And that's why the Scottish Government is supporting the No One Left Behind policy, which will devolve further funding to local employment partnerships in each local authority area in Scotland. But yes, I'm very keen to learn more about the example the member highlights, and we'll make sure I do that in the near future.
Thank you. Question number six, Gillian Martin, who again joins us remotely.
To ask the Scottish Government how it will support the North East economy as it faces the effects of EU withdrawal and the pandemic.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes, who again joins us remotely.
Well, the Scottish Government recognises that the economy in the North East is facing multiple challenges, and we're actively supporting economic recovery in the North East with up close to £100 million to support businesses and additional funding of almost £150 million to councils to help achieve that. We're also investing £157 million in the Aberdeen City Murray growth deals and over £14 million to develop the skills needed to support regional economic recovery. Presiding Officer, we are actively supporting economic recovery in the North East.
Gillian Martin.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Infrastructure will play an important part in the economic recovery of the North East, particularly in terms of better connectivity. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what transport and digital connectivity infrastructure has been funded or being considered for Aberdeenshire and how gaps in connectivity are being addressed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would agree with the member that investment in transport and infrastructure is absolutely critical, and I know how active she is in representing her own constituency interests in that regard. We are investing £5 million in digital connectivity infrastructure through the Aberdeen City Region deal, helping to deliver digital projects connecting around 200 public sector and NHS sites across Aberdeen City. And the side package commitment includes £10 million for digital projects in addition to the R100 programme. But in terms of transport, we've also recently awarded the North East £12 million from our bus partnership fund to enable work to be taken forward on the development of the Aberdeen Rapid Transit system, as well as delivering significant bus priority in the city centre and on key routes into the city. Presiding officer, I could go on about a number of other investments, but I'll leave it there. I would be happy to follow up in writing to the member detailing all the investments we're making in digital and infrastructure.
Very grateful, Cabinet Secretary. Question number 7, Willie Coffey.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its discussions with the UK Government regarding the digital economy and digital single market.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, on the 28th of September, I provided the Secretary of State for Digital, Culture, Media and Sport with a detailed response to the UK Government's plans for digital regulation, a key feature of the digital economy, and I called for continued alignment with EU data protection standards and improved coordination across the digital regulatory landscape. And in terms of the digital single market, we continue to engage with the UK Government in order to minimise the risk of losing data adequacy and to maintain the free flow of data between the UK and the EU digital single market for Scottish businesses.
Willie Coffey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? She will be aware that the digital single market is worth €400 billion per year across Europe, and that Scotland's businesses are being denied access to this, but with no thought or guidance from the UK Government about what they intend to replace it with. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how she sees this going forward and how Scotland can continue to be part of this crucial market for Scotland and Scottish business?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is right that as a result of leaving the EU and its digital single market, Scottish businesses have lost substantial membership advantages, which the Scottish Government is having to mitigate. We are, for example, reducing the compliance burden for businesses in accessing the digital single market by taking steps to reduce regulatory barriers and local presence or representation requirements. We're also engaging with the UK Government to ensure that the ongoing positive data adequacy decisions with the EU remains a priority, and not agreeing to provisions in trade agreements with non-EU countries, which could put that at risk. And lastly, we're building on cooperation with the EU on emerging technologies and ensuring that Scotland retains policy authority for future regulation related to digital developments.
Thank you. Question number 8, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of UK Government policies on the local economies of areas of high multiple deprivation.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Analysis conducted by the Scottish Government highlights the harmful impact of UK Government welfare reforms upon the most vulnerable people in Scotland. A report from June indicates that key policies from the UK Government, including their callous decision to cut universal credit by £20 per week as of today, will reduce social security expenditure in Scotland by £586 million by 2023-24. This is particularly worrying as the costs of food and energy increases, the furlough scheme ends and national insurance contributions are hiked. The UK Government's senseless and harmful decisions to remove this lifeline while costs of living rise will hinder communities across Scotland, and it demonstrates why full powers over social security should be held here in the Scottish Parliament instead.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. Along with colleagues from around the chamber this morning, I attended a demonstration outside the UK Government building up in East Market Street to campaign against the £20 weekly universal credit uplift being taken away. Does the Minister join me in calling on the UK Government to reverse this decision, damaging the living standards of those affected, and also on the basis that this inevitable lowering of local expenditure will damage small businesses within deprived areas of Scotland?
Minister.
I will join with Bill Kidd wholeheartedly. And as I said, Scottish Government analysis shows that this cut will result in an extra 60,000 people in Scotland, 60,000 people, including 20,000 children, being pushed into poverty, and hundreds of thousands of others will be pushed into hardship. And the reality of this, as the Children's Commissioner for Scotland has said, this cut will, and I quote, effectively knock out the benefits that the Scottish Child Payment will bring to families. Which is why, unsurprisingly, there is such broad political opposition to the cut. Except, of course, from the Scottish Conservatives. who were happy to defend this callous cut last week in the Chamber.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a slight break before we move to the next item of business.